For nearly 150 years in Detroit, through diphtheria and smallpox, polio and penicillin, from the world's first successful open heart surgery at Harper Hospital in 1952, to the biggest investment in the city's history, $800 million, building America's most modern hospitals right here in Detroit. DMC, always there.
The views and opinions expressed on Detroit Wants to Know with Steve Hood are not those of WADL TV 38 or Adele Broadcasting Corporation.
People moving out, people moving in. Why? Because of the color of the skin.
Run, 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 but you sure can't hide.
The teacher, segregation, determination, demonstration, integration, aggravation, humiliation, obligation to my nation.
That's what the world is today. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. You're watching TV 38. This is Detroit Wants to Know, and I'm Steve Hood. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to talk this afternoon about the emergency financial manager crisis in Detroit. One entity that is already under financial manager control, one that is severely heading there. This week's Detroit Free Press reported that $100 million of federal grants was misspent by the Health and Human Services Department. They specifically detailed an incident where over $210,000 of the grant monies was spent on furniture when it was supposed to be spent on serving the poor and helping in the food pantries. This is obscene, ladies and gentlemen. This is money for the poor. And you know Detroit has a whole lot of poor people. But it gets worse. Also this week, the Planning and Development Department revealed that in an audit for the last 2 years, they've been mismanaging federal block grant funding. I don't know if you know about federal block grant funding, but this is what is used to help nonprofits provide services to the neighborhoods and to the poor. It's just a bad thing. You really need to read the Free Press this week and pay attention to that article, because these are monies that should not be misspent. So on one hand, you have misspending. But in March, the Cranes Detroit Business reported that 31 of the mayor's top brass have left over the last 22 months. So what do you get when you have mismanagement of federal funds plus high staff turnover? You get taxation without representation, which, ladies and gentlemen, is the same thing people are claiming that is going to happen under the emergency financial manager law. Taxation without representation. Well, in Detroit's case, this taxation without representation leads to oblivion. This is obscene. You got to call the mayor's office and tell him to stop this madness. Problem is, an old friend of mine, very large gentleman, once told me, if you don't learn from history, you die from history. Mayor Bing has a history of this. Back in 2002, when he had Bing Steel, he had over $300 million in sales. He had over 1,130 employees on staff. That was in 2002. Guess what? In Detroit today, he has no employees. That company's in oblivion. And companies are still owed money by the former Bing Steel. I don't know if they've settled that by far, but he left them hanging when he closed down. Now, that's an example of an entity heading towards financial management. The next entity I want to talk about is already there. That's the Detroit Public Schools. And I want to welcome Mr. Roy Roberts, formerly of General Motors, to Detroit Public Schools. Mr. Roberts, and you can see his quote right here, is all about making the Detroit public school system better. But Mr. Roberts, let me say this. You've already stepped into a nest of bees because of the fact you have not gotten rid of the rest of the Robert Bob administration. Number one, you need to set the tone and have a clean slate. You don't need any preconceived notions. So the first thing you need to do is get rid of Mr. Bob's former press secretary, Steve Wasco. He was the face and the voice of Robert Bob, and it sends a subliminal message to the citizens of Detroit that nothing's going to same. You're still going to have still the mindless, draconian cuts, no caring for the people. Don't do this. And speaking of Mr. Bob, he's going to write a book. He says he doesn't have a title yet. Well, you know what? I'm going to give you a title. How to Take Care of Your Cronies, Take Care of Your Friends, and Hurt the Students of Detroit, and Live to Tell About It. Ladies and gentlemen, when we get back, I'm going to need you to have your pens and pencils ready because there are new developments in the mortgage crisis that you must know. This is Steve Hood. You're watching TV 38. This is Detroit Wants to Know. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to TV 38 WADL. You're watching Detroit Wants to Know. This afternoon, I have my good friend Ken Gross from Fav Gross. And he's going to tell us about the new these new developments in the mortgage crisis. I thought this thing was over, Ken. How you doing, buddy?
Steve, it's good to see you.
All right. So tell me, what's happening?
Well, first of all, the mortgage crisis is far from over. It hasn't stopped for a second. People are still behind in their mortgages. People are being foreclosed. The foreclosure rates are going to be going up, not down. But there are two new developments that people need to know about. One is there's a law called the 3205 law, which was passed in July 5th of 2009, and it provided that in order for a lender to foreclose, the lender had to first give the people written notice, and if you responded within 14 days, it stopped the foreclosure, put it on hold for 90 days, and gave the people an opportunity to modify the mortgage, a mandatory mediation meeting. Now, a lot of people didn't avail themselves of this right because they didn't respond within the 14 days, but many people have. And we've represented a number of people that do respond within the 14 days, and the result has been very positive in modifying mortgages. Here's the problem. That law expires July 5th of this year, 2011.
That's a state law?
It's a state law. It was passed 2 years ago. Everyone thought, housing problem, it'll be over in 2 years.
I did.
Well, the housing program's going to be around for probably another 5 years, the way things are looking. And we need the legislature to reenact that law, to extend it. So there's a couple bills pending, but everyone's jibber-jabbering about the governor's budget and the tax, the tax shift from, to business. And no one's concentrating on this. So what people need to do is you need to call your state rep and your state senator or email them and tell them to extend 3205.
What about calling state reps that are not yours?
Call everybody.
Call everybody,
Call the media. Call everyone you can possibly call because it's the only good law that came out of Michigan to help people modify mortgages. And in fact, it's the only good law nationwide. The national programs, the HAMP program by the federal government, is a disaster and a joke. There was millions of dollars given to the state of Michigan to help people, help for homeowners, and none of that money's been dispersed at all. This is one law that didn't cost the lending industry anything, and it's actually working, but there's not enough action and interest to get people to pass the law.
Okay, let me ask you this question. What is MERS? And what is going on with this MERS entity?
MERS is the second big issue. MERS is called the Mortgage Electronic Security Registration System. And if you ever...
Say that three times. Mortgage Electronic Registration System. All right.
If you go and look at your mortgage, you'll see that the lender, instead of the lender's name being the mortgagee, the party that owns the security interest, it always says MERS. And MERS is the mortgagee, and they were called a nominee. Well, April 21st, the Court of Appeals in Michigan rendered a decision that held that any foreclosures by advertisement, which is all houses are foreclosed in Michigan, any foreclosures by advertisement where MERS was the foreclosing party were held void, invalid. This is a major, major decision. The result of that means is if your house was foreclosed any time in the last 6, 7 years, 3, 4 years, and MERS was the party foreclosing, that was an invalid foreclosure.
Invalid foreclosure.
Invalid.
So what do? They bring the big dumpster back, put all your furniture back?
Well, it's a good call. We've started a class action lawsuit. We're suing all of the lenders, every lender that used MERS as a mortgage, as a mortgagee.
Which lenders around here did that?
All of them. Chase, Bank of America, One West. They've all used MERS. MERS is the mortgagee on every mortgage since 1993, except for limited circumstances. Now, Not everyone falls into this category, because what's going to happen is if you've been foreclosed and you look at your mortgage, you look at your paperwork, you're going to see the MERS name on there. But the question is whether MERS actually foreclosed. If the paperwork says that the mortgage was assigned by MERS to the lender and then the foreclosure occurred, this decision doesn't apply. But if the paperwork just says MERS was the foreclosing party, then this decision does apply. So anyone who's been foreclosed absolutely has to go to their paperwork and make a determination as to whether this affects them.
How many people do you think this affects?
It's probably in the range of 50 to 60,000 people over the last 4 or 5 years statewide.
Okay.
And a tremendous number of them in Wayne County, Oakland County, Macomb County. You know, the vast bulk of them. How do you find out? The easiest way to do it is you go to if the lender sent you your sheriff's deed after the foreclosure and you have it, if you sent that in to me or to our office, we can look at it for you and tell you whether or not MERS applies or not. If you don't have your sheriff's deed, you should go to the registered deeds office and request it with attachments and then send it in to us and we can look at it.
So let's say your class action lawsuit goes through, what happens?
Well, it's an interesting issue. First of all, this case is going up to appeal, so you don't know what's going to happen with the Supreme Court. But the basic claim is this. In Michigan, conversion occurs when someone exercises wrongful dominion and control over your property. All right, well, if your house is wrongfully foreclosed, what better example of exercise of wrongful dominion and control when they throw you out of your home? The Michigan conversion statute provides for treble damages. That's three times the value. So if the lender bid at the foreclosure sale $200,000 for your house, claiming that was market value,
they owe you six.
They owe you six, less, I suppose, what you owe them, because you had a balance on the mortgage. So there's a significant claim out there. Whether at the end of the day this is going to level the playing field and get back for the people what was taken from them, I can't say that. But you certainly need to get into the game and try and get your fair share of what's occurred.
Ken, when we come back, we're going to talk about loan modification and short sales.
Two other big areas.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're watching Detroit Wants to Know. This is TV 38. We'll be right back.